Good afternoon to everybody who has stayed until this last presentation in today's program. We will not speak about demographic processes and demographic development, but instead our focus is on the development of the data sources on which the analysis of demographic processes rests. And more specifically, we focus on population census. And in a way, we link to Andres Vikat's presentation, but we take a more country-centered perspective. Here is the outline of our presentation. At the beginning, I will give a short background about the quest for alternatives to the conventional or traditional census. And then I will look briefly also into the alternatives to this conventional data collection mode, in particular the register-based census. And then in the second part of the presentation, Luule will take over and introduce a study, a methodology development project, which was just completed a couple of months ago, for the next census in Estonia in 2020. And Luule will share some results from this project. Well, to begin with the quest for alternatives to conventional census, to put this quest into a broader perspective, we decided to shortly give a timeline how we have arrived at this point that we quest for alternatives for the modern census. And you probably all know that censuses as we know them today are the product and companion of societal modernization that took start in the 19th century, just like maybe railways or telegraph lines. And all these important principles, universality and simultaneity and so on, all these principles were actually in place in the middle of the 19th century. And what followed was increase in the coverage of population censuses from a small part of the world in the 1800s to more or less complete coverage in the aftermath of the Second World War. And of course, this time was not wasted in terms of methodology development, and all these procedures and approaches were perfected, and this process is still going on. And we can basically say that it has been a big success story, that censuses are really today a backbone or pillar of the statistical systems, and they are widely used and badly needed. So, against that background, this title of the next slide may be a bit surprising, but I borrowed it from a British demographer, David Coleman, who published the article "The Twilight of the Census Without Question Mark" last year. And I also couldn't resist the temptation, and I included here on the top of the slide the first sentence of this article. Coleman likes metaphors, and this is one of such metaphors here. So I don't know, are the lights going on out or not, but there are a lot of arguments raised against conventional census, and I will not go through them all, but probably the high cost is one of the very clear reasons why statisticians are looking for different alternatives. And I was surprised a couple of months to learn this number for Estonia. It is not a peak year of the census, as you can see, but it is the middle of the five-year period that the census took nearly half of the resources of the statistical office. And of course, there are other reasons. So Statisticians are smart people, and they are devising solutions to these challenges and problems, and there are several solutions. First, and probably the oldest solution, is the distinction between short and long form census questionnaires. It means that the majority of the population receives a short form, relatively basic questionnaire, and then the other a smaller part, usually some 10, 20, maybe sometimes 25% of the population, gives answers to the long form questionnaire. A step further from this cost-saving approach is dropping the long-form questionnaire altogether. This means that only short-form stays, and long-form questionnaire is replaced actually by a large-scale continuous ongoing survey. And this is practiced, for example, in the United States currently, with American Community Survey having some 3 million respondents annually. So these more detailed continuous estimates are derived from the survey. And one even more radical approach is implemented in France since mid-2000s, and you can say that in France both the short form and long form were dropped, and they were replaced by something that is called a rolling census. It is, in essence, a very large survey with, that covers in five-year periods about 70% of the population. It has a big advantage of giving annual estimates, but it also means that we have here a retreat from the census principles of universality and simultaneity. Finally, well, there is a different approach, which is internet-based self-enumeration, and we have seen that Estonia has been quite successful in implementing it. And finally, we are getting to register-based census, which is by many considered the best alternative to all these problems and challenges. And why is that? Is because of the advantages of the registers in for producing statistics and including the census. Judging from literature, there are at least five advantages here. And if you look at them, then you can see that they basically respond to all of these challenges, which were in one of the previous slides. The cost efficiency, the reduced response burden, we don't have to go to people and ask the questions, and the timeliness, that we can have a census annually or even with more with greater frequency if we wish. And then accuracy, some data, some errors are less pronounced in registers, others are maybe more. But then yet analytical advantages, which are probably the favorite part for researchers. There are possibilities that we can go beyond having the census like a standalone data set, and we can connect this to other data sets and look in longitudinal perspective how the population changes and develops. These advantages are very impressive, and if we look on the practice, I have here also the data from the most recent census round, a little bit more concise group of countries, but you can also here see that the register-based data collection was quite widespread in the recent census rounds. There are in this table 39 countries, and 18 of them, it means that 46% were using census registers for obtaining their census variables. But Another message from this table is that it is still quite difficult to get all the data from the registers. And this takes us to some limitations which we have also to keep in mind. And I'm repeating what Andres already said, that the main limitation or source of limitation is actually very simple, that registers are not designed, developed for statistics. They are developed for other purposes, for administration, it's very difficult to take into account all these elaborated statistical concepts and definitions using the register data. And now there are different manifestations or expressions of how this mismatch can be using register data, but the main challenge, yes, is that if we want to use registers more in statistics and in censuses, then we have to very carefully address these different points where the statistical definitions procedures cannot be implemented in full. And which is also visible from the previous slide, that there is quite a big variation between countries, that the readiness of registers is very much different. And here I will pass the word over to Luule, who will speak more about our study and what we found on Estonia on this readiness issue.
Thank you. And so I will go further what we did in this project, which was concentrating on the possibilities of elaboration of the methodology for a register-based census. So the main aim was to assess exactly the feasibility of register-based census in Estonia. And of course, part of it to identify these obstacles, what are on our way to such a path. And also identify how to overcome them. Our project concentrated only on core topics which are mandatory from the EU directive for this round of censuses in 2010. And that meant that we only dealt with 27 so-called variables, which are non-derived, and around them, the derived ones. We used analytical approach, which first was on the meta level, which meant that we identified whether the definitions, concepts are in compliance, and whether the data for that certain item is at all available in registers. If the answer from the meta-analysis was yes, then we went on to analysis of microdata. And we tried then already to construct such a census variable and assess the quality of the variable through various record linkages to other surveys and what was available by the time when we had finished from 2011 census. The project was enormous. Well, it means that aside of our institute and Ernst Young Baltic, who were the main partners to statistical office, There were several experts from Tallinn University Institutes, Tartu University Institutes, as well as several legal and infotechnological experts. And of course, the analysis from our statistical office were mainly carrying out the microdata analysis, and several consultants came, of course, from the registers themselves. So in the end of this project, we have produced 40 meta and microdata analysis reports, a legal analysis report, algorithm report, that is when really a variable could be constructed, then we apply such a logical understanding how one should proceed in the future for that, and final report summarizing all these several reports in one document. And now about more what came out of this project. As I told, there are, we dealt only with core characteristics of this EU directive, and we found complete compliance with EU directive definitions for four variables. We found partial compliance, which means that there need to be done several efforts in order to achieve a full compliance for four variables. And the others mainly fell to so-called, we say here, limited compliance, which were the majority of the variables characterizing both the person characteristics as well as the housing characteristics, and found three characteristics which are not available throughout the registers in Estonia. And these three were occupation, location or place of work at the level of local activity unit, and industry also at the level of local activity unit. So with this map in mind, how do we go on? And first of all, I think that it is much broader framework that we have to take on if we set ourselves for register-based censuses. And it is a real change in a general mindset, not a thing which concerns only statistical office. First of all, it means really a real cooperation between different agencies, including ministries and their registers, as well as the National Statistical Institute. Because, as we heard already in the morning, maybe, but also today, that if we really want to have statistics to be register-based, then we want to be it in compliance with all the definitions and all the world. That means that we should more consider in the registers, which are now for administrative purposes, more statistical needs. Also, we hear a lot arguments for register-based censuses that they might be cheaper. But we have to be aware that this development of such a system needs considerable investment. And we might learn in the end that it is less expensive compared to the traditional census only at later stages in the long run, but not possibly in the short run. Also, for the response burden, we always argue that register-based censuses are for reducing response burdens. But if we really want to have data from registers, then we have to allow ourselves to give more data into registers, which means that either we give it to statistical office or to the register, but for a time being, our burden really increases. Also, it most probably is one of the such more, how to say, soft areas, but we have to deal also with so-called registration culture, which, as we see it, is part of civic culture. And we should not underestimate it. That means that we have to do a lot in raising public awareness how really statistics can be used on our behalf. Because statistics is nothing in itself. It's only to make a better basis for all of us to make the decisions, wherever we are. So, in the end, it means that there is a lot of cooperation. If we go to those more concrete results, what I showed earlier, it means that we also have to find the way how to have these new characteristics in the registers, which we do not have now. As we know, at the moment, statistics, our statistical office is under the Ministry of Finance, as we all know. And Ministry of Finance at the moment is pursuing a new legislation on jobs, whereas it has not taken into account the appeal from the statistical office, the same under its ministry, to have the new characteristics in the new job register. So if the same ministry who is taking responsibility for two different agencies does not recognize where we have to go, then who else? Then we cannot expect that Ministry of Justice, for instance, will be for it. Also, one of the main challenges, as we all know here in Estonia, I don't know how it is in Latvia and Lithuania, but the main problem is the accuracy of residence registration. And we see it that this is the real critical precondition for any register-based census. At the moment, practically we could say that 20% of persons have different address in register than in the current census. But having so, it means that all our household, family statistics, housing statistics will be affected. And as we just heard from the previous section, one of the main challenges what is there for statistics to produce is data about households, families, and housings. So, in principle, we also, in our report, did not find one and only solution. And also, we cannot grant any fast solution. But there are possibilities to go towards such a development, and that means that we start to analyze the registration behaviors, the incentives and their effects on local levels, and bringing them to our politicians to decide whether these incentives should be maybe on the level of the country, if they affect to such an extent our registry of residents. Also, the registration of institutional population practically has, nobody knows anything about institutional population in Estonia at the moment. But there are possibilities how we can go on. But that means a real collaboration between different ministries and their registries, which also means whenever it comes to registries, it means new variables, new costs, and that means it's not very inexpensive. Also, as we now have very different mobility exchanges, as we just heard today, we know our main partners, and these partners are mainly those who do have registries. Why shouldn't our country registers exchange their data with these countries? It's not so difficult, and I hear that there are some already movements towards this better exchange. And of course, we should better use our registers for different analysis in order to understand what is going on. Another thing which we should maybe tackle and then also think, we should turn to our archival data. And we know that as relies to legal marital status and relationships between family members, much has been done already by Ministry of Interior to computerize such data. But it's not only these, but there are also some gaps still left to be filled. But it's not only these variables. It also applies to education. It also applies to the age of housing, which all we can derive from archives. Also, what we see here in Estonia, as Estonia has a very big proportion of foreign origin population, and as we see, they are coming in more and more, so it doesn't go away, and we are having more foreign origin population also in the future. That means that we should also improve our registration procedures so that we should have on this population complete data. We should have it on education, their previous marital status, their relationships between family members and so on. And additionally, of course, we should somehow also address those immigrants who are already in Estonia, which means that maybe when we are again changing our ID cards, passports, land passports, and so on, or any other instances when we go to authorities, maybe we should ask for the documents which are missing for them. There are several more outcomes what we have provided also for dwellings to be better registered, all registers to have address standards in order to really exchange the information on the basis of a housing unit. But it also means that the registers themselves should have new quality checks, also publish them, improve the descriptions of the register data, because often they themselves do not remember how they have got this data in the beginning. And there are some new classifications to be executed and others reformatted, so to say, to the standards what are there. Also, we should more use the 2011 census for comparisons what were very scarce during our project, but as you know, this, what we analyzed, are only the core topics. We as a country would like to have also those topics what we are used to have over the, so to say, from where do we go, 1867? The first one, so over the years, and that is yet to be started. And also, census is not the only issue for registries. What is the benefit of register-based census? The benefit, real benefit, is that we can do it every year. But before we can do it every year, let's start it now, doing it every year, and see whether our registers, with 1 year after another, come closer to the international definitions, what we are so proud of today. So, the main conclusions from here, that yes, 2020 around register-based census in Estonia is a real challenge, but it is definitely worth to pursue. Although National Statistical Institute is responsible for the census, the majority improvements are beyond this institution. And that means that it needs a real inter-agency cooperation on a very high level. But despite what, so to say, the agencies, governments decide, it also concerns all of us. Because what data shall we have in the future depends what we give into the registers. And that means that we ourselves have to cooperate with everything to be in this into this area, so that we can again maybe have not a world record anymore, because there are five already there, but maybe a world record with best compliance. Maybe, because today the main challenge is how to maintain this compliance. So there is a possibility which we give now over to a statistical office to pursue, and hope to be part of it for the next decades to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we have time for questions. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Eric Schotnot from Statistics Netherlands, being one of the register-based census countries. So first of all, it was a very nice presentation of the two of you. You said lots of true words, I think. I have a remark and a question. I want to start with a remark about which country is a register-based country, which country is a combined census country, which country is a traditional census country, because there were some differences in the slides you showed and the slide that Andres showed earlier today. That's kind of an update, because some countries have been kind of reclassified. Currently, we have 9 European register-based countries with a census. Yes, but that's the 2010 paper. There's an update this year, so yes, just...
Citation there.
Yes, so yeah, that's fine. Yes, no problem about that. No, just a remark. My question is, you concentrate very much on the compliance with the variables that are mandatory in the EU. And that's logical to do, and I think it's quite a challenge to become world champion in complying there. But on the other hand, we have to realize that there is no country that is fully compliant for all variables. There are always some missings, some errors. So you try to comply as much as possible. That is something to keep in mind. So I was wondering, have you taken that into account? Have you also looked at the register-based countries we have now and how well they comply and where their problems are? I think that would be an interesting thing to study further.
Yeah, we visited all the... countries and got the overview from them as well. So we are quite aware about the challenges ahead of them as well as us. But we were looking for the best compliance, and it's possible in principle, to the standards. And if we cannot even make a dwelling, then we cannot address the dwelling-based household as well to be in compliance with the other 24%, which is not compliant with the UN definitions at the moment.
Thank you very much. More questions? I have perhaps a naive question. we are working towards register-based census, but does it mean that since 2020 we have, so to speak, continuous census, so we can get the exact population size every day or every week, or so Prime Minister sees the exact number on his monitors every morning.
Well, that's up to us to decide whether we make it possible, because as you heard, there are a lot of challenges, and if we overcome all of them, then of course we can take it whenever we want it. But most probably, even for statistical office, it won't be reasonable to have all the resources for publishing every day's, I don't know, number of population. But it can be, I think, the number of population is very possible.
Thank you very much.
I think in Finland it is, even every day you can see what is the number of population.
It's important.
Yes. Well, you usually time, there is always too little time for these kind of changes to happen, and one census is chasing the other. Now, you were presenting a lot of difficulties and still concluded in the optimistic note, it is worth to pursue. Now, one argument that usually can help in this context, I don't know whether these 20 reports, do they include any financial analysis of this exercise? So, because these can be very strong arguments that make the wheels turn, and maybe it is worthwhile to show how much savings, because that is what is happening in the United Kingdom, if you are aware of their project, also very thorough, they analyze also the cost aspect of different solutions. So they are probably not the best example because they are not aiming at the register-based census, but as in terms of analyzing the different options. So maybe this is one of the of another thing worth to pursue.
Thank you. I think Statistical Office will take it into account with the arguments with their ministry.
Okay, I don't see more questions. So let us thank Luule Sakkeus and Allan Puur for the very interesting presentation once more. I also want to thank all the speakers, both international guests and local speaker, for their very informative and interesting presentations this afternoon. Thank you very much. And see you tomorrow at 9.